Okay, so good morning everybody. Thank you for coming and joining our session. As my colleague said, it's really a short introduction to the topic, just to begin slowly the day, because it's a long day, as you've seen, it's 19 papers. I'm with Lennart Linde, part of the prehistoric conflict research project at the Goethe University in Frankfurt. More exactly, Bronze Age fortification between Taunus and Carbassian mountains. So if you're interested in the topic, you can have a look on our own page. So, are hill forts meant to be just defensive places? Some reflection about the function of hill forts. Hill forts are mainly identified through their defensive features and marks of armed conflicts. To illustrate this point, I wanted just to show you some examples. Some are very good known. You have in Germany, for example, the Eunuchenburg, which was excavated from 1993 to 1987. It's 1.5 hectares, and the fortification is dated during the late Bronze Age, 10th and 9th century BC. There is three periods that have been identified for that fortification. The first has only a wood soil rampart, then we have a stone wall, and then a big part of it is a cyclopean wall. The particularity of the Eunuchenburg is that more than 70% of the bronze artifacts are weapons. These weapons were located, as you see on the map, in the gate area, so I'm sorry, it's a bit small, but all the red dots are all kind of weapons, and it's all concentrated in this gate area, and you have a reconstruction of it. Among these weapons, there are some fragments of sword. All are dated to Hallstatt B2, B3 types. But the archaeologists are thinking that these fragments are not due to the battle, but maybe a ritual destruction. There are at least 11 spearheads. They are all damaged. And they found 107 arrowheads, and they are all banned. There are also some fire marks on the side, so all these clues let the archaeologists think that it should have been here a battle. Another kind of violence on the side is, for example, the site of Sintana in Romania, where they found a lot of sliding projectiles of clay, and they were thinking that they were actually burned and sent with fire to burn the houses inside. But maybe we will hear later a bit more because someone is presenting about Carpathian Basin. And the last one you probably never heard about because it's one I was excavating this summer. It's the Senkersberg as well in Germany. On this site, we have until now, after three campaigns, 23 arrowheads of bronze. Most of them are as well bent, and we have also a nice spearhead. Another fact that you probably know, the phenomenon of the vitrified fort. I'm not telling a lot about this because it's not the point of today, but it's another possibility of violence at the end of the Bronze Age in Europe, since a lot of sites are concerned with this fact. Again, the Senkersberg, where I was excavating, which is about 6.7 hectares, has a big stone wall of basalt, and this basalt, as you see on the picture, is sometimes completely melted. So it looks like a bit like slag. We have another famous example from Germany, it's Bernstorff, where they did also some experimental archaeology. And here you have a Wurzel rampart, which was as well burned. We can you can see the burnt clay on the picture. So let's come to the head and focus of our session. We just want to look behind violence and defensive aspects of the hill fort. Oh, sorry. So, that's it like this. What is the role and function of such sites to society, in economical networks, or within the border landscape? Are these fortifications for protection or just having a symbolic meaning? That's some questions that we can have today and then discuss later. Some possibilities are the case, for example, of hill forts with plenty of hordes. Some of them are seen as a political center or as a sacral area. I just want here to mention the Budenheimer Berg in Germany, which is a huge site, more than 30 hectares, with a rampart up to 2 meters high preserved, when one part of it is made of stone wall. On this site, they found 19 hordes, so and a lot of single finds. Among them, you can find wagon pieces, horse gear, tools, weapon, ornaments. Most of them are dated to the late Bronze Age, really the final phases, so Altstadt B3. You have also gold pieces like arm rings, gold sheet, and so on. The next possibility is to have maybe some specialized center with craftsmanship skills, a center of production. As an example, I would like to present you briefly the site of Fort-Aoix in France. It's well known for French archaeologists. I know that at the European scale, not that much, but it's quite interesting. It was excavated already at the beginning of the 20th century, but then again in the 80s. It has a big occupation of the Middle Bronze Age and Late Bronze Age. It's about 7 hectares and has a rampart with a defensive ditch, which is around 6 meters deep. They found on the site a lot of clues about clothing manufacture, which was apparently very developed since they have 210 spindle walls, a lot of loom way of clay, and a lot of needles. They had as well a lot of pottery kilns and all the tools that you can use to decorate pottery, like the on the picture you have a pin with a head with cycle, there are comb, burnisher, spatula, so all the set is on the side. But above all, they have a really, really rich collection of metallurgical artifacts. So all the steps of the chaîne opératoire for the metallurgy of the bronze are identified. There are some workshops with ball furnaces or other kind of kiln. There is 173 fragments of stone and clay molds. These molds were for anvil, pins, daggers, swords, spearhead, bracelets, so everything almost. They also found a lot of tools for the metalwork, like chisels, saws, punches, hammers, whetstone, anvils, and as well as a lot of ingots, mainly of copper and lead, so they think that the bronze alloy were made directly on site. They found also for this metallurgical step crucibles, lumps and other screw blast pipes. In total, it was 1,252 bronze artifacts, so from ornaments to tools and weapons, and all this together, this density of workshops and the few objects on site, if you compare with this lot of molds and so on, let the archaeologists think that they were exporting all the production for the hinterland. Another interpretation that you may find in the literature as well is to have sight on a particular topographical position to control trade routes. For this, I'm not taking directly an example from the Bronze Age, but from the Iron Age. In Hessen, you have the Glauberg. Well, it has also a small Bronze Age occupation, but it's really good known for the Iron Age. And you have a study from Beitinger in 2006 with old trade routes. And in Hesse, you have two old routes that are well known. It's the Ansanvia and the Ortesweg. So you have them colored red and orange. They are well known in the antiquity, and they are probably going back to Iron Age and maybe Bronze Age. And I completed the map with two sites I was excavating in our project, the Kleinberg and Stahlberg. And this way, the Ansavia is as well running down to this hill. So maybe it could have been also a point why they choose to have a fortification there. So after this really short overview, I'm just reminding some points about the station, because Lennart already presented you a bit. So we have today 7 blocks. The first one is about theory, and then we are going Parisian clockwise from west to east, foremost to the Mediterranean Sea. We have 19 papers, and we are talking about 12 countries. About the organization of the day, so as you know, we have coffee break at 10 and one at 4, and then a lunch break at 1. And please, for the speaker, be on time, because it's a long day, we have a lot of people to hear, so maximum 15 minutes. We have the marks, we will use them, and keep your question for the discussion slots. Yes, thank you, hi. So thank you very much for joining our session.